everyone, and very happy to discuss few of the points again. Just on the previous day to Shivratri, the most important and auspicious time for the Rasa people, because we are the people invariably to become devoted to Lord Shiva, and this is Shiva Shastram what we are discussing. And to discuss with more of the aspects, we'll go into the next shlokas. So we'll go into the Rasaratna Samuchaya second chapter, shloka number 75. Wherein he starts with the Makshika Dhatu. It's a discussion on Swarna Makshika. Again, the most important drug, because we have already discussed in the chapter two, the initial part. I said like these two drugs are very, very important for Rashastra. One thing is Abraka, one more is Swarna Makshika. Because they are a combination, they're a sort of alloys, a different component which we are using in our patients, and it gives a huge impact because of these varied compositions. So when we read the shloka number 75, Suvarna Shaila Prabhavo Vishnuna Kanchano Rasaha Tapyam Kirata Chineshu Yavaneshu Chanirmitaha Tapyaha Suryasu Santapto Madhave Masi Drushyate. So wherein he speaks about it is a gold like parvata, which is similar to that of the gold, and it was available in the Sumeru mountains, which was being bought by Lord Vishnu, and he has placed it next to the Tapati river. And this is especially which runs in the areas of Kirata Desha, that is the Bhutan, the present Bhutan, the China, and Evanadesha. Evanadesha is the Turkestan. So you have the Bhutan, China, and Turkestan. So these are the areas where it moves. And here are the huge hordes of Swarna Makshika. This is true even today. I will say Acharya has written the textbook in 13th century, but still these things are really important to understand how these people could study so much of geology. What he spoke, Suvarna Shaila Prabhavo, the first word, Suvarna Shaila Prabhavo, where he tells the whole of the mountain is just like Suvarna Shaila, is just like gold. He tells Prabhavo, Prabha, where you have Suvarna Shaila Prabhavo. It's only a Prabha. He never told like Suvarna Shailam. No. He has used the suffix as Prabhavo. Means it looks like gold. It looks like gold. And he speaks about Suvarna Shaila Prabhavo in the sense, it's a mountain which looks like gold in color. So Prabhava in the sense of how it appears. It's only having the Prabha of it. And you know what is it's called as in English? Swarna Makshika or pyrite or chalcopyrite, what we call. It's called as fool's gold in English. Based on mineralogy, it is called as fool's gold. Why? Because people consider this is gold. But basically, this is not gold. This is fool's gold. In English, Makshika is called as fool's gold. The first word he mentions is about the fool's gold there. He tells Prabhavo, the word is mentioned. He never said like it is Swarna. He knew, even though it looks like gold in color, it is not Swarna. It is Swarna Shaila Prabhavo. The Prabha of it is Swarna Shaila. And it is gold in color. Vishnuna Kanchano Rasaha. It is also which produces, or which is especially from the Sumeru Parvata, and also he bought it, Lord Vishnu has bought it, and he placed it next to the Tapati River. where in Tapati River? Towards the zones of Bhutan, China, and Turkestan. So these are the deshas like Kirata, China, and Yavana. Wherein he placed it. Wherein he placed it. He created these mountains or he placed these mountains. Nirmitaha is a word which is being used there. Tapyaha Suryamsha Santapto Madhave Masi Drushyate. He speaks when it should be identified. It shines brightly due to the intense sun rays, as you see in case of the Madhave. Madhave Masa is nothing but the Vaishaka Masa, which comes in the month of May. So once it is in the month of May, you can see the bright sunlight which falls on these mountains, make it to appear more like that of a golden aura, something like the mountain glazes with golden color. So this is about the Swarnamakshika. So he tells about the golden aura there. He speaks about the Prabha, the word which is used there, means the Acharya knew the difference between the chalcopyrite and gold. He was not fool, and he named it as the fool's gold as Swarna Makshika. This is just like the appearance of honey. Makshika is also a name for honey. Honey is golden yellow or golden brown in color. Similarly, Swarna Makshika. When you see the Swarna Makshika, it is really, it appears something like gold. It appears just like gold. That is Swarna Makshika. So he was a great geologist to identify these features there. So running to the next sloka, the sloka number 76, wherever he speaks about the properties of the Makshika. And in the properties of the Makshika, Acharya has explained, Madhuraha kasha, Kanchana Basaha Sa Amlo Rajata Sanniba. So in case the Makshika, which is gold in color, is Madhura Rasa, whereas the Rajata Makshika, which is Rajata Sanniba, is Amla Rasa. And also he speaks about Kinchid Kashaya Madhura Shitaha Pake Katur Labuhu Tat Sevanat Jara Vyadi Vinashayana Irna Paribhuyate. So this is very much useful. The Gunakarma, just like you explain about the herbal drugs in Dravya Guna, the similar way he speaks about the Swarna Makshika there. But he speaks about one more thing is Jara Vyadi Vinashane Pari Bhuyate. Means what he is speaking about, it is very much useful in geriatric practice because Jara Vyadi Vinashane. So it is good to remove the disorders of geriatrics. So what are the disorders of geriatrics? Jara is the old age or the geriatrics. So what are the disorders which you see in case of geriatrics? There are many disorders very specific to that of the old age, but specifically you find this old age complaints which are being seen or which are being observed by the people, especially when they have Vata Pradhanaja, because Ayurveda speaks about Vayoratri Bukthanam Tenta Madhyadika Krama. So on that way, specifically when you have Vata at an outset, which is at a higher end, where the body is emaciated, the Dhatu Saratha is deteriorated, there is no much Bala in the body. There is no much Bala in the body. Even the Ojas is very much moderate. So this is a deteriorative condition. And that's the reason at this moment you are supposed to use Makshika. So on that grounds, whenever you have the patient who is suffering from these clinical pathologies, like whenever you have him with emaciated conditions, you have the conditions wherein the person is very much deteriorated, the ojas is being affected, or ojo rasa is being observed in the patient, you're supposed to give him Makshika. And if you people can remember this in Ashtanga and also in Charaka Sushruta, wherein you get the information about the Makshika in the form of Tapyadi Loha compositions. This is Tapya. The synonym of Makshika is Tapya because it's available next to the Tapati River. And this particular Tapya is also being explained by the Brihatrayis. And in the Phalashruti of that Tapyadi Loha, he speaks about Apurayat Deha Dhatun, means the Deha Dhatus, which is apurna or asamyak, is being completed. It becomes samyak, it becomes upgraded. So similarly is this particular condition, wherein whenever you have the emaciation of the dhatus, whenever you find the muscular dystrophy like conditions, whenever you have the deterioration like conditions, whenever you have vata pradhana, or you find some conditions wherein you have atrophies. So on this grounds, what we do, considering this particular feature, we specifically give Swarnamakshika in the conditions of ischemias and atrophic conditions. It is specifically that this is the reason why Makshika is a prime ingredient in all the cardiac tonics. Many people add double the concentration of Makshika in Prabhakaravati. Why? Because Prabhakaravati is very much useful in cardiac complaints. Prabhakaravati is, I say, you have any patient with cardiac illness, blindly you can give Prabhakaravati. And people add double the dose of Swarnamakshika there just to see that this impact, what you have, is being excellent. And I have seen many companies like where they increase the quantities of Swarnamakshika, they give the similar product as Prabhakaravati, and it is very, very effective clinically. Swarnamakshika as cardioprotective is really wonderful. It is really wonderful. That is because Jara Vyadhi Vinashaihi Paribhuyate. That is the reason why this Swarnamakshika is to be used in the cardiac complications or cardiac conditions. The next shloka is 77, wherein he speaks about Makshika Dhatuh Sakalama Yagnam Prano Rasendrasya Param Hi Vrushyam Durmela Loha Dvaya Mela Nascha Gunottaraha Sarva Rasayana Agryam. So this is what he speaks about. So here the Acharya is speaking about the Makshika Dhatuh Sakalama Yagnam. So this is universal. This is one such drug which can cure all the disorders. So when do you need this drug in your clinical setup? Sakala Amayaginam means when the patient is so deteriorated that he has landed up into multiple organ failures or multiple systemic involvements, more than one srotas has been affected, or there are some clinical conditions wherein the person is landed up into multiple organ failures, wherein the person is landed up into multiple systemic deterioration, as you see in case of Rajayakshma. Rajayakshma is not alone a tuberculosis-like condition. It is a condition wherein you have the patient suffering from multiple systemic involvements, wherein the person is having multiple systemic involvements and is deteriorating faster and faster. So in those conditions, you're supposed to give, the more and more you learn, more and more you expertise in your subjects, less and less number of drugs you prescribe it to your patients. This is the fancy of learning more so that you practice with less number of drugs. So one such combination could be greatly attributed to that of Swarnamakshika. You can just take a small concentrations of Swarnamakshika and give it to the patient who is suffering from multiple organ failures, end organ failures, where you have the systemic illnesses. Many times I will say, whenever you have this particular condition is being very well appreciated clinically in the people wherever you have the tendency of multiple organ deterioration. And you know, when you have the multiple organ deterioration, it is very commonly seen in the patients suffering from a chronic diabetes or uncontrolled diabetes, and also in hypertensive conditions, wherein hypertension is called as a silent killer. It's going to deteriorate multiple organs of the patient. So whenever you have such clinical presentation, you should see the patient suffering from diabetes. Multiple organ failures are very common. Diabetic retinopathy, diabetic nephropathy, diabetic neuropathy, you know, so many pathies are there. So this is the complications of diabetes. So such complications, whatever you have, a person suffering from diabetes, don't wait for the multiple organ failure to happen in him. I would strongly recommend for all the patients who are suffering from diabetes to take the Swarnamakshika as rasayana, so that it will not make the end organ failure. It doesn't make the systemic damage to happen, because it is having this Falashruti as claimed by Acharya in Rasaratna Samuchaya as Sakala Amayagnam. Sakala Amayagnam. And this proves like it is the one of the best drug which can be given. Because when you see the Dravya Prashasti, which is an ideal drug for the practice, he speaks one drug which can act in more ways is said to be a very ideal drug, wherein one drug can be used in so many disorders, or one drug can be used in many clinical conditions. So this is one such drug, like the Swarnamakshika, wherein it can be used in many clinical conditions. Or when you find like multiple systems are being involved, the patient is suffering from diabetes, hypertension, thyroid issues, patient is having arthritis, anemia, giddiness, many complaints together. In those conditions, you can blindly prescribe him with Swarnamakshika Bhasma. So you need to consider the patient condition and definitely try to prescribe him with such things as Swarnamakshika Bhasma. This is the most important phenomenon, a clinical perspective, what Acharya Vagbhata has been recognized, the clinical action with Swarnamakshika. And I will say, these things are not just theoretical as claimed here. They are very, very practical. You try to give it to your patient for a longer term and try to see the observations in the patient, provided you use chalcopyrate. Because many times, unfortunate to say, I have seen many of the companies or many of the people where Vimala is being named as a Swarnamakshika, they prepare Bhasma because both the end products look red in color. And it is being marketed out in the name of Swarnamakshika. But in fact, iron pyrite is different from chalcopyrite because this is chalcopyrite which is having copper in small concentrations, whereas iron pyrite doesn't have copper in it. So there is a slight demarcation, there is difference, but there is a greater demarcation in clinical perspective. So this is the importance of Swarnamakshika. And next he speaks about is a Prano Rasendrasya Param Hi Vrushyam. Prano Rasendrasya, he tells it is Prana of the Rasendra. In what sense are we supposed to take this terminology called as Prano Rasendrasya? So Prano Rasendrasya in the sense, it is considered as a life or the survival or the existence of Parada. Rasendra is nothing but Parada. So Prano Rasendrasya, you don't want the Parada to die. You don't want the Parada to become inactive or inert, then you need to add Swarnamakshika into it. During the process of Ashtasamskaras of Parada, Acharya speaks about lots of differences, like wherein the person speaks like the Parada loses its virya. And after that, you process it with various methods in Ashtasamskaras so that the viryavan bhavati paradaha. So it becomes more stronger. It becomes more stronger. So on that grounds, what we do here, we definitely go for adding up Swarnamakshika to such conditions or such prescriptions. Whenever you have any of the formulation, you're moduling any new formulations, or in case if it happens, like you start to have more and more prescriptions, which you are doing, might be it's a patent product, or anything like where you want to generate a new composition to the patient and where you want the Parada to be more active in the end product. Might be it is Mrityunjayarasa. Mrityunjayarasa doesn't have Swarnamakshika as an ingredient. But I will say for one batch of drugs, try to see that you add very small concentrations of Swarnamakshika Bhasma into Mrityunjayarasa and administer it to the patient. You see the clinical efficacy in that particular group of patients where it is Swarnamakshika Yukta Mrityunjayarasa. Similarly, you have for Tribhuvanakirti and other conditions, definitely. But the Parada or the mercury which is present in your drug becomes more active or more bioavailable, or it is more therapeutically stronger in case if you give it with a combination of Swarnamakshika, which a combination of Swarnamakshika. So this is an advantage of how you should go for the understanding of Prano Rasendrasya. You are supposed to administer it to the patient wherever you have the mercurial preparations, whenever you want the mercurial preparations to act for a longer time or to have the more potency in a clinical perspective, you're supposed to add the Swarnamakshika into it. Param hi vrushyam, it is aphrodisiac. It also senses in a different way because it doesn't allow the pratilomakshaya to happen in the patient. Pratilomakshaya is from the shukra upwards. So it doesn't allow the patient to land up into the pratilomakshaya. Due to some reason, the patient is having excess of shukra kshaya. and if it is not treated, then it is going to affect the previous dhatu and then the that previous dhatu and eventually deteriorates all the dhatus. Then it is called as the pratiloma kshaya. And this particular drug, not only it is aphrodisiac, but this drug is also arresting the conditions of the pratiloma kshaya. Dur mela loha dvayo melanam. So this is an important phenomenon. There are two components which are not mixing to each other, and by adding swarnamakshika they start amalgamating or mixing or becoming a unique component. So durmela mela loha means two metals, when they don't mix, then you need to add swarnamakshika so that it becomes a unique component. And can somebody guess which is turmela loha dvaya? Which drug in our syllabus is really durmela, which doesn't mix? Which are the two metals which is present in Rasashastra syllabus which doesn't mix? The chemical reaction between these two metals is inert, it's inactive, it doesn't act, or there is no chemistry between these two in a significant way, because durmelana, it never mixes. You want them to mix, then you need to add swarnamakshika into it. Can somebody guess which drug is that durmela? Which are the two drugs in your syllabus which is really durmelana, which never mixes with each other? Say for example, I take iron and copper, I take gold and silver, I take naga and vanga, I take jasada and naga. I take any two metals and try to mix it. And I will say frankly, when it becomes molten or in some state, most of the metals will mix. They become a unique component. But there are two metals in your syllabus which never mixes together. And the answer for this particular thing is, it is mercury and iron. So mercury and iron will never mix. There is no chemical reaction between mercury and iron. They are very inert. That is the reason why the mercury, when you want to purchase in large scale, it comes in iron cylinders. It comes in iron cylinders. They never mix with each other. They are called as durmela lohas. They never mix. Iron and mercury will never mix. But there are many formulations, because when I read about the chemistry, I have read about this concept called as iron and mercury are inert. But there are so many hundreds and thousands of formulations where you have mercury and iron together in the similar composition or similar formulation. There are so many formulations where you have mercury and iron together. But when you have this composition as mercury and iron together, how did Acharya manage to see like they turn therapeutically active? Because they need to act separately in the body as a mixture, but never as a compound. But in case if it happens, like you want to make it therapeutically strong, or you want to see that you want to mix up mercury and iron together, then in those conditions, you're supposed to mix swarnamakshika bhasma into that formulation. So when you have a particular composition or particular formulation where you have swarnamakshika, loha and parada together, it's an excellent composition. It is an excellent composition. Why I say this? When you have a patient suffering from any of the above said clinical conditions, you want the sukshma guna to act in the patient, you want atirasayana to act in the patient, and for that you have chosen mercury to give to the patient. You want the therapeutically activities to be seen in the hemopoietic system, then you try to give it with the loha bhasma. But unfortunately, I am a student of chemistry, and I know that mercury and iron doesn't have any chemical reactions. So on that grounds, what do I do now? I do add swarnamakshika to that composition and I give it to the patient, then it is therapeutically very, very active. That is durmela loha dvaya melanam. So it makes these two components to mix. It makes these two components to be therapeutically active. It makes two components. Such similarly, you have many components. you have many components. One thing is mercury and iron, where you have this in so many prescriptions. Similarly, you have zinc and copper. Jasada and tamra, they are inert. Jasada, when you mix with copper, jasada decreases absorption of copper in the body. Similarly, copper decreases the concentrations of jasada to get absorbed in the body. But there are so many formulations where you have jasada and tamra together. So when you don't want this to act as a mixture, instead, I want them to act as a compound. Or when I want the more therapeutic efficacy of these compositions, then I add Makshika. Then I add Makshika. So this is the second example. The third example, when you read the chapter on, we will be coming across in the further chapters where you have the Marana Siddhanta, Dhatu Marana Siddhanta, wherein the Acharya is explained about the context about the Lohanam Marnam Seshtam Sarvesham Rasabasmana. So where he speaks about the Marana Siddhanta, in the last of the shloka, he speaks about Arilohena Lohasya Maranam Durguna Pradam is a word what he uses. Means every Loha is having a Ariloha. There is an enemy element among the drugs. So when you kill it with this, means when you do the Marana of the prime drug with the Ari or the enemy drug, then it causes toxicity in the patient. Because he speaks Arilohena Lohasya Maranam Durguna Pradam. It is Durguna Pradam. So these Arilohas, whatever are there, few of them are minerals, few of them are metals. So whenever you have this metallic components as Arilohas, like Naga for Parada. So similarly, you have much of the metals which are enemies, which are Arilohas. Whenever you have this Arilohas, then you want to somehow substantiate it or neutralize this efficacy as an enemy drug in the Marana Siddhanta, then you need to add Swarnamakshika there. You need to add Swarnamakshika. This is the reason why during the Marana of Swarna, if you can read the further chapters in Rasaratna Samuchaya, in the chapter of Swarna, one of the Marana of Swarna is with the Swarnamakshika Basma. Because people started to kill gold with lead. Naga is the Ariloha there. So you want to see that somehow Naga and Swarna should not interact in a toxic way. Then people started to do the Marana of Swarna Basma with Swarna Makshika. So if you read the chapter of Swarna, you will come to know Swarna Makshika is used as a Marana Gana in Swarna. Why? Because of this concept. That's the reason why you have Durmela Loha Dvaya. So this is the reason why the knowledge of these acharyas was tremendous. I'll say even today, the modern science, many places they have restricted these enemy metals like zinc and copper, mercury and iron, lead and gold. Combination of these things has been very significantly down. But acharyas did not lose the game there. They put their efforts to the next step to see how best I can manage them, how best I can see to see that I can manage them. To explain about this context in a very simple layman language, there are two students in my class who always quarrel together. They are always quarreling together. But it happens like in my presence, I'm a teacher there. So in my presence, both of them, even though they don't like each other, they tend to be fine. They sit quietly in the classroom and listen to my class, make a notes of what I do and rehearse the things, which makes them effective individually together in a same class. The same component is being done as Swarnamakshika. It is a teacher, whereas the two lohas are enemies, which are unsuitable to be added in a similar compound. But by adding Swarnamakshika, those two separate metals will become like friends. They tend to move together. That is a way how we have to understand. Durmela loha dvaya melanascha. So this is the way how the Acharya has really challenged the chemistry and made it more feasible. Next is Gunottarah Sarva Rasayanagraha. So it is Gunottara, it is going to always increase. Uttara, Uttara in the sense it's in ascending order. You go on taking it, it goes on giving you more and more. Don't take Swarnamakshika as a Rasayanartha for 1 week, 10 days, 15 days and say, yeah, I've taken Swarnamakshika Basma for 15 days. You take it for more time. Gunottara. More and more time you take, more and more will be the Rasayana effect. More and more will be the Rasayana effect of it. So on that grounds, what you need to do? You need to consume Swarnamakshika Basma for a petty long time so that it gives you that Rasayana effect. Sarva Rasayana Agraha, it is Agra Rasayana, it is Shrestha Rasayana or Sarvottama Rasayana. So this is the way how we have to go with it. Next shloka, it is the two types of Makshikas which has been explained in shloka number 78 and 79. He speaks about the Swarna Makshika and Tara Makshika there. Makshiko Dvido Hema Makshikas Tara Makshikaha Tatradhyam Makshikam Kanyakubjhottha Swarna Sannivam. So this is Kanyakubja, is nothing but the Kanauj area, which is having a luster as that of gold. The one which is able to be shown in the shores of the Tapati River looks like Panchavarna Suvarnavat, just like five different colors or five colors of the gold. It is something like, frankly, to speak about a 5% of gold. So it happens like we have done the Basma of Swarnamakshika. The rodra did not show any components of gold. But the end product, when you go for the Swarnamakshika Basma Nirmana, in the XRF, few times, not all the times, few times, we could elicit traces of gold in the end product in Swarnamakshika Basma. So this is the reason possibly Swarnamakshika has been used as a substitute to Swarna. As a substitute to Swarna, because there are some small traces or small concentrations of Swarna in Swarnamakshika Basma. So this is how you need to go with it. Next is about the Shodhana. Shodhana is pretty well, very easy to understand. It's shloka number 80, wherein the various methods of Shodhana has been explained. And of course, everyone would have done this Shodhana of Makshika. Similarly, it's about the Marana, wherein it has been done by Bhavana with the Mathulungarasa. Usually you give the Gajaputta or Varahaputta. I strongly believe in giving it with Varahaputta. I never give Gajaputta for Swarnamakshika. With the 350 Upalas is very, very convenient for it to be converted into the Basma. Mathulunga, or you can go for Erandathaila, or you can use ghee for Bhavana, Sharavasamputta, and subject it for the Krodaputta, by which you get something like Swarna Gairika Varna, or the Gairikaba Basma, which is said to be Rasayana Vidhi, Vidhinavapi. So it is going to become just like the best Rasayana. He speaks about it should be used as Rasayana. The next shloka is about the Sattvapatana, properties of the purified Makshika Sattva. The next shloka, yeah. Then next he speaks about the administration of the Sattva and the Dhruti of the Sattva. So they are the general practicals which has been clearly explained there. There is no much to interact. Might be if in case if you have any doubts later on, we can discuss about the method of Shodhana, Marana, Sattvapatana and all. Dhruti Kalpana, of course, it has been explained, but nobody have probably done it with the Dhruti Kalpana, which is explained in the shloka number 90. So this is about the Swarnamakshika. The next thing is about the Vimala. Vimala has been explained in the shloka number 91, wherein he speaks about Vimala Strividha Propta Hematya Sthara Purvakaha Trutiha Kamsya Vimala Stadha Kantyasha Lakshyate. So he speaks about the Vimala, which is of three varieties. Vimala is of three varieties, basically Hema Vimala, Tara Vimala and Kamsya Vimala. These are the three types of Vimalas, which has been explained by the Acharya in this particular shloka. And in this particular shloka, wherein he explains Hemai Vimala is considered to be the best variety. The next is a Tara Vimala, and the third variety, but which is usually used in the medicinal purpose, is a Kamsya Vimala. It is the Kamsya Vimala. Tara Vimala is used for Rajata Karma, and Hema Vimala is used for Swarna Karma. So this is what he speaks about. But the next thing what he explains is Vartula Kona Samyukta Snigdhascha Falakanvitaha Marut Pitta Haro Vrushyo Vimalo Atirasayanaha. Where he speaks about Vartulam Kona Samyuktam. So he speaks about Vartula, it is round. Also it is Kona Samyukta. So you have them in geometrical shapes where you have the edges, corners and all. And also it is Vartula, which is round with no geometrical shapes. It is round. You have something called as pyrite sun, which is very easily available to you in nature today. Pyrite sun is nothing but the iron pyrite, which is not into any of the geometrical shapes. It is just like a ball. It is round. It is just like a ball. Whereas the Kona Samyukta, what you have is of geometrical shapes. So here, for example, the Acharya did not go into the details of the Kona Samyuktam. He speaks about the geometrical shapes and he left it. Whereas when you read the chapter in the same chapter in Ayurveda Prakasha, he speaks about the Kona Samyuktam. He speaks about Trikona, Chatukona, Panchakona, Shadukona, Ashtakonam Vapi. He uses the word. Means it is a trigonal, cuboidal, penta shape. It is also dodecahedral and also octahedral. So it is pentagonal, heptagonal, tetragonal, dodecahedral and octagonal. It is trikona, chatukona, panchakona, shadukona and also ashtakona. He speaks about it is all geometrical shapes and all these things are available. You have a pyramid-shaped natural iron pyrite. You have a cuboidal shape. You have pentagonal, which is almost a 5 or 6-cornered. You have octagonal, 8-cornered, dodecahedral. It is like bipyramidal. All shapes of iron pyrite is available in nature even today, including the Vartula. That is a pyrite sun. It is called as pyrite sun, which doesn't have any corners and edges. It is circular, that's all. So it is snigdhascha falakanvitaha. It is snigdha and also it is falakanvita. It is having plaques. It is having planes. And it is smooth. It elevates vata and pitta and it is very good in aphrodisiac and also it is rejuvenator. Marut pitta haro vrishyo vimalo atirasayanaha. Purva Hema Kriya Sutho Dvitiya Rupya Krunmataha Trutiyo Beshaje Teshu Purva Purve Gunottaraha. So the one which is Hema Vimala is used in Hema Karma. Rajata or Rupya Vimala is used for Rajata Karma. Whereas the third one, which is very much useful in medicinal purpose, and also it is Gunottara. It is very much useful. Next is Shodhana of Vimala in Atarushakvata. It has been done with Swedana, just like you do the Dola Yantra. And we can use the Swedana, you can use a lemon juice or Mesha Shringi. It has also been performed with the various methods. The next one is about the Marana of Vimala in 95, wherein he speaks about to do the Marana with that of Lakucharasa Bhavana. Might be you can add sulfur there, Gandaka. Sharava Samputa and 10 Gajaputas. Vimala usually takes around 17 to 18 putas and you need Gajaputa. You need Gajaputa. If you give more bhavana, means you can give exclusive bhavana, then definitely you can reduce the number of putas. Next is Sattvapathana, which is in shloka number 96 and 97. Next, he speaks about the other methods of Sattvapathana and the administration of Vimala is being explained in the next one. The soft mass or the pishti, it's been prepared by grinding together the fine powder of the Vimala Sattva and also by the use of mercury. Tat Sattvam Suta Samyuktam Pishtam Krutva Sumarditam Vimali Gandake Kshiptva Jareet Trigunalam. Yeah, Trigunalakam. So this is how he speaks about the way, how it should be given. How it should be given. Next is about the Vimala Rasayana, wherein you are asked to give about the 2/3 of the 2 to 3 rattis to the patient, along with Trifala, Trikatu, and Grita. It is very much useful in the disorders like Jwara, Shota, Pandu, Prameha, Agnimandya, Arshas, Grahani, Shula, Kamala. No doubt, the Vimala Rasayana, it is very, very effective once you start administering it to your patients clinically. This is very, very effective drug which can be useful in most of the clinical conditions. So this is about the Vimala. The next thing which we'll be discussing is about the Shilajitu. In the shloka number 104, where he explains about the Shilajatur Dvidha Prokta, Gomutra Adhyo Rasayanaha, Karpura Purvakashchanya, Statradho Dvividaha Punaha, Sa Satvascha, Nisatvascha. So wherein this is the one where you have two types at gross. One thing is about the Gomutra Shilajatu, second one is called as a Karpura Shilajatu. Again, the Gomutra Shilajatu is having two types. One is Satatva and Nisatva. Satatva, where you have the trace elements, because you have the classification of Shilajatu as explained in Charaka and Sushruta as Swarna, Rajata, Loha, and Tamra, whereas Sushruta has added Naga, Vanga. So you have the varieties of this, means in which mines it is available, so that those trace elements are present here. The Shilajatu is being extracted from the bitumen wells, where it's an anaerobic chemical reaction which has happened in the beneath, in the earth crust. In the absence of air, there are many plant and animal products which get decomposed in an anaerobic zone. And this has been linked or sourced out because of the heat of the sun, where you have a connection. You have the huge rocks right from beneath the earth, and they are pushed out on the surface of the land, of the lithosphere. Then you have the oozing of these Shilajatu as the bitumen grooves, where you have some amount of bitumen which comes out, just like a straw. You have a groove by which the Shilajatu oozes out. Of course, whatever the Shilajatu you are getting today in the market is fake. A genuine quality of Shilajatu is really not available to us, or it is very, very rare to occur, or very rare to procure or use it. But today in the market, you demand for tons, it is available. It's only a bitumen. You're not really using the Shilajatu, which has been explained here in the textbook. And for that, he explains about the way how it has been done. This is about the bitumen grooves, which he explains in the next shloka. Grishme tivrarka taptabhyam padobhyo hima bhubhrutaha swarna rupyarka garbhebhyaha shila dhatur vini saret. So wherein he speaks about how it has been extracted out. This is about the bitumen grooves. So it is available in various forms, where you have the ores of gold or silver, iron, copper, anything. And he explains about the colors of it. But the most important part in the Shilajatu is about the Shilajatu Pariksha, where he speaks about one hyo kshiptva bhavetat lingaha karam adhumakam salile apyaviliram chatachudham hi Shilajatuhu. So one how kshipta, when you place it over the fire, bhavetat lingaha karam adhumakam. So it goes into the shape of a lingakara because of its specific density there, and it becomes adhumakam. Why adhumakam? There is no organic content in it. It is very much inorganic. It is a rotten substance from an organic material, but basically this is inorganic. The end product here, what you have is inorganic, and this particular inorganic substance is adhumakam. If you have organic component mixed in it, then it becomes a sadhumakam. If it is inorganic, then it becomes adhumakam. Because many people add trifala into this, gomutra into this, to increase the bulk and to behave something like they are giving you some a genuine product, and you get appeased very much. But when you pour it on the fire, it gives smoke, means it is treated with some organic materials. So you are being faked by taking such shilajitu. So don't take it. Salili apyavilinam. So it goes deeper and then slowly dissolves or it mixes up. Satat shuddham hi shilajatu. Then you consider that as the good quality of shilajatu. Next, he speaks about the properties. Properties wherein the Acharya is speaking about various disorders. I will say when you read the chapter of Charaka Samhita on Shilajatu, I think you can cure all the disorders on earth. He has given lots of praises, even in conditions like diabetes, prameha, and many conditions. He speaks as if there is no disease on earth which cannot be cured without Shilajatu. Or if you have Shilajatu in your hand, which is a very strong weapon for your clinical practice, but still you're taking something, a false Shilajatu possibly, you're taking the tar, the damber, which has been poured on the roads, the tar road. So it has been processed with Trifalakvata, with Gomutra, everything. And it has been given to the people to consume it. Poor body, it has been digesting the same thing. The tar, which is laid on the roads, is also being taken by the humans. And the most fortunate thing is, whatever it has been done, it is still effective with the humans. If not to the level of what is being explained in the textbook, to the praises of Shilajatu that it can cure all the disorders on earth, but still it is effective in many clinical conditions. But for anyway, in case if it happens, like you tend to procure a real Shilajatu, you need to know what are the qualities of it. So such a Shilajatu is being exclusively used in the clinical conditions as Jwara, Pandu, Shota, Prameha, Agnimandya, Sthaulya, Kshaya and Shula. It is also used extensively in the conditions like Gulma. It is used in Plihodara, Udara, Rutshula, and also in all kinds of Kushta. It is also used in all kinds of Kushta. It is useful in reducing the Ama, and also it is used for achieving the Deha Siddhi and Loha Siddhi. So it is also having the various properties resembling as the Rasadravyas. It's having a property as a set of drugs. It is very, very effective. It has been used as a substitute to various metals and minerals, and it is so effective. The Shodhana, the next sloka in 111, where it has been washed with the Kshara or Kanji or lemon, anything. Trifala, Dringaraja, Yavakshara. Next is about the Marana. Administration of Shilajatu. He speaks about the Basma, but instead of Basma, Shuddha Shilajatu is into the practice. As you see in case of Chandra Prabhavati or Arogyavardhini, Shuddha Shilajatu is used. But still, Acharya explains here as the Basma of Shilajatu to be mixed with Kantaloha and Vaikrantha and should be used in the patients. And it has been used along with the Trifala and Trikatu powders. This is Basmi Bhuta Shilodbhavam Samatulam Kantam Cha Vaikrantakam. So that shloka, wherein he uses a combination of drugs. Next is about the Sattvapatana, and next is about the Karpura Shilajatu. Karpura Shilajatu is with a tinge of Pitavarana or yellow, crystalline, just like sand. It overcomes the disorders of the Mrutra Kuchra, the Mutrava Samsthana. You have like conditions of Ashmari, Prameha, Kamala, and Pandu. Also explains about the Shodhana of Karpura Shilajatu in the Yalakvata. No Marana is being explained for Karpura Shilajatu by Acharya Vagbhatta. So this ends about the Shilajatu. In the next chapter or in the next shloka, in the next class possibly, we will be going across with the Sasyaka or Tutta. So any doubts you people would like to discuss about all these three drugs like Swarnamakshika or Vimala or Shilajatu, I think we can discuss for some time. Is it fine, Dr. Meenakshi?
So perfectly, sir.
Yeah.
This was a very concise and appropriate description regarding the Maharasa. within 45 minutes we have covered three with so much precision, which is very much required actually for clinical sense. So I welcome all the questions, and sir, we have 2-3 questions. Like, in clinical practice, how can we differentiate between any prepared bhasma like Swarnamakshik and Vimal? How to differentiate between the two? Is it possible?
The basic components, like what you have with that of Vimala and Swarnamakshika, is something different. See, Swarnamakshika is gold in color. When you read the Graha Lakshana of Swarnamakshika, he speaks about it is gold in color, whereas Vimala is like iron-like. Both are entirely different. Most of the times, the available Vimala is in geometrical shapes. Vartula Vimala is, of course, available, but it is rare to occur. Whereas Swarnamakshika is a Nishkonam. It is not having the geometrical shapes. It is irregular most of the times. Whereas Swarnamakshika is having copper as a component, which makes it to give a sort of a golden look. And Vimala is not like that. It is always having a sort of a iron look, because it's having a iron pyrite as a component there. So these are some basic differences, how we can differentiate them in a practical ground, one thing. Second thing is, Acharya has also asked us to do some basic tests for this, because for Swarnamakshika, he speaks about the term called as Kashe Ganakavat Grishtam. So when you do the streak test, he knew about the streak test. It's not like the streak test from the geology is from the 20th century. It has been definitely taken by the Acharyas right from the period of Rasaratnakara and Rasaratna Samuchaya, wherein you take a small piece of Swarnamakshika and rub it over a hard surface. You find a dark green with a golden hue. You have a Kashe Kanakavat Grishtam is a word which is being used for Swarnamakshika. The streak test for Swarnamakshika is gold, whereas for the Vimala, it is not golden color. For Vimala, it is usually black in color. Or very few times with the high concentrations of iron in Vimala, it makes it with a white streak. It gives a white streak. So this is how it is being related, or how we need to differentiate between Vimala and Swarnamakshika.
Sir, one more question. Can the method to identify fake and genuine Shiladit, I think this was discussed, containing organic and inorganic part. And sir, can you suggest some pharmacies which make authentic Swarnamakshika Bhasma?
No, I don't want to advertise any of the pharmacies. The best part could be you procure the drug by yourself and prepare your bhasma and use it in your practice. That could be the best part, if at all you can do it. Because I don't know. See, I'll say in 2017 and 18, nearly 150 to 200 delegates have visited my clinic. In a seminar wherein many people could purchase the Swarnamakshika or the chalcopyrite with some 400 or 600 rupees per kg. Later on in the next year, it turned 1,050 per kg. And in the previous year, it turned to 17,000 rupees per kg. This year, the good quality of Swarnamakshika is 37,000 rupees per kg. So it is quite expensive, provided you have good concentrations of copper in it. In case if the concentrations of copper are less, the cost is very much low. It's very economical. Again, you have it for even hundreds, or might be its maximum is 1,000 or 1,500 rupees per kg. But in case if it is good concentrations of copper in it, then it comes to 37,000 rupees per kg. This is what for the bulk. I don't know if at all we take it in retail counters.
So, sir, is it that if the company is selling the bhasma for a maybe higher price, then there is more possibility of being genuine?
Yes, the possibility is very less. Many times I heard like people wherein they're using only Vimala and naming it as Swarnamakshika. I have few times written letters to various shops where we purchase some raw drugs. Even though you write them for Swarnamakshika, they'll send you Vimala. So this is a very wrong thing. This one should be, Swarnamakshika should always be gold in color. Yeah.
Then so we have. Can we take bornite for Swarnamakshika?
No. So bornite is being taken for Sasyaka. We'll discuss about that in the next class. Bornite we are taking for Sasyaka. Here we are taking chalcopyrite. Chalcopyrite is also available in blue color. It is again golden blue, because Ayurveda Prakasha, while explaining Swarnamakshika, he speaks about Kashchid Neela Chavihi is a word he has used there. So you have a blue colored chalcopyrite as well, but it is different to that of bornite. Bornite composition is different, whereas a chalcopyrite, which is blue colored, is different. Chalcopyrite is different, and iron pyrite is different in respect to the chemical compositions.
Yeah. So, Prano Rasendrasya, is it related with the Ranjan or Saran grass of Parad, as most pit contain Makshit?
Yeah, definitely, because once you speak about the Ashtadasha Samskaras, you speak about lots of Swarnamakshika Sattva, which is to be used as Prano Rasendrasya. So similarly, like you have used many places the use of Swarnamakshika, it is used as Grasa. Of course, the same thing is what I said, like you want your preparation to be more therapeutically active, add small concentrations of Swarnamakshika into the component, by which it becomes very, very potent.
Sir, yeah. Is there any reference of traces of gold in Makshik Bhasma? Are there any references?
No, this is a XRF analysis which is done for the Swarnamakshika end product. It's a just a project work, not from the textbook.
Yes. Sir, can we potentiate, or how to potentiate the Pratinidhi Dravya like Swarnamakshik somewhat nearer to Swarna, if possible, for clinical application?
No. We cannot substantiate it, because the component's chemical composition is totally different. This is a composition of copper, iron, and sulfur, so chalcopyrite, whereas gold is entirely different. But only thing is, possibly the very small concentrations of gold, what we find in the end product, should be one of the reason why the Acharya has named it as a Panchavarna Suvarnavat, where it is very small concentrations of gold-like in the end product.
So there is one more query. Like in market, we have, for Shilajit preparations, we have drops, we have tablets, at the same time we have powder.
Yeah.
So which form we should go for? Is there any difference in efficacy also? Like, we are a bit confused how to use and which form is more better.
I will say, you take the solid form, the rock form of Shilajitu, you extract it by yourself by boiling it in Trifala, filter it, extract the Shilajitu out, and you boil it for more time, just like you do for the Gudapaka, it becomes a powder component. You want to use it in the form of a paste, like what you see, something like a semi-liquid or a paste formation, which can be used for the preparations like that of Arogyavardhini or Chandraprabha and all. Even that is quite sufficient. It's not like it is more effective, which is more convenient for usage. That's the thing. There are many powder compositions in patent products wherein people want to use a Shilajitu as a component, wherein you can make it into powder. But many times I will say, the Shilajitu which is available to us today in the market is very, very hygroscopic. We can really not convert it into powder. It is highly paste in consistency, and once you leave it outside in a plate or something, like, it is hygroscopic, it absorbs lots of moisture, and it never converts into powder form. If you want to convert into the powder form, again, you need to be chemically treating it, or you need to add some other powders and make it into powder. get it to the powder form, or else it is hygroscopic. Many times I have seen people in small scale industries, once it is turning more hard and tar like, people add lots of godanti basma into it. People add up trifala churna into that. High concentrations of trifala churna, almost 1:1 or sometimes even 1:1.5 is being added, and they get the end product in the form of powder. But unfortunately, let me say, even trifala is many times hygroscopic. It turns something like a hard shell, like if you leave it on air. So on that grounds, people started to add bit of trifala and bit of madhyashti. Sometimes people add even godanti, anything and everything to make it in the form of powder. So I don't think that's a real way. Bitumen is always pasty in consistency. Use it as it is natural. That's a better form.
Yeah. I think Dr. Pallavi wants to, she has raised hand. She wants to ask a question. Dr. Pallavi, please unmute yourself.
Yeah.
Sir, I have an extended question. So you mentioned about the differentiation of Vimala and Swarnamakshika. So if we have bought Bhasma, so yeah. Can we differentiate in the clinic level or analysis is necessary for that?
The best part could be in case if you can go for the analysis, in case to see the copper content. But in case if you want to clinically test it by yourself, what you need to do is take small concentrations of potassium ferrocyanate, mix it with water, it becomes potassium ferrocyanate solution. To that you add whatever the basma, you don't know whether it is Vimala or Swarnamakshika. In case if it turns blue color, then it is Vimala basma. It turns to green color or greenish blue color, then it is Swarnamakshika basma.
Okay.
Because it shows the presence of copper there.
Okay.
Yeah, that could be the easiest way which we can do at a clinical level. You need not send it for any labs or investigations. Or you have the another method is NPST, Nambudiri's face spot test. That could be another way which you can do.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Jyoti also wants to ask a question. Dr. Jyoti, please unmute yourself.
Namaste, sir.
Namaste.
Sir, here people from Nepal come to sell Shilajit. They use it is a lump of Shilajit in form of long rods, and when they put on the surface, it breaks up into two parts. And again, they join it, and they claim that it is real Shilajit.
It's not Shilajit. It is not Shilajit. You want to test it, I will say take a small portion from him and you do the test in the classical way. Like you do a tatlingakara madhumakam apsumajjatvam. So you do this test. This is the most confirmative test. They have processed it. Many times what they have given is really not aspartam. What they have given to you is something different. They sell it out at just a throwaway price. There are so many people, I'll say, whenever you travel to the zones of Uttarakhand or Himachal Pradesh, parts of Himalayas, you have some of the tribes, they get Shilajitu, they mix with small concentrations of mercury, and they'll show you how mercury disintegrates into Shilajitu. And they say, see, this is a good test for Shilajitu. There is nothing such a test which has been explained in the classical textbooks. Let us not get excited by seeing such tests by the people conducting there. It's nothing but an amalgamation process, how it is the mercury getting disintegrated into Shilajitu. Need not use it.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
I also asked Dr. Jyoti to please thank sir for his wonderful
Sir, a great thank you from my side, being a student on this auspicious occasion of Shivratri. It's just like listening Shiv Purana prior to Shivratri. Sir, when we listen to your classes, it's just like a dose for us, booster dose. Every time we fail in our practice, some of your classes come and we get answers in those classes. So I always believe this thing that whenever I am in some problem or something, you come in either way in classes or anything, I will get my answer through these classes.
Good.
So
nice.
sir, it's a very nice session, and I also thank Meenakshi ma'am for taking such a good initiative, and it is really fruitful for all of us. And sir, I am very lucky to be your student. I still remember the day when I came to Koppal from this Rajasthan, and I really cried over there ki where I came. But now I am very much blessed to be your student, and I always want to be your student in next life also. So I humbly thank you, sir, and to ma'am also, to all the team. And we can hear your lectures for hours and hours together, sir. We want to be a student endlessly in every life. Thank you, sir. And I got the vision from you regarding Rasa Shastra, which I am using in my clinical practice. And tomorrow there will be Maharudra Abhishek at our home for the Shivling, which you gave and which got sthapit in our home. And it's a really blessings for us. Ma'am, the Shivling has done wonders for me in my home, and I'm very lucky to have it with me. Thank you, sir. It's always your presence for us. Thank you very much, ma'am. Thank you very much, sir.
These are the direct words straight from the heart without any kind of mixing. So natural, so natural, without pouring expression.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank
and now
you, ma'am.
We can all you, proudly ma'am. Say we all are strength of sir. Now we can say, sir, initially we used to think, how can we study from sir? He's so far. How can we, sir, we can approach you, we can study. See, now technology has bring us so much closer that we are just a screen apart, just a click. And see, sir is right now, all of us, and delivering his lectures, we are getting maximum benefits. Such is the blessing of, I think, technology. This is the right kind of use that could be ever made out of technology. At least we are blessed with this thing. This is the best that could happen in that whole corona period, sir. So at least this is the greatest boon to us.
Ma'am, it's just like Nagarjuna moved to other places to teach all of us. In the same way, sir is teaching us by use of technology.
No, COVID has brought everyone together.
Yes, sir.
It's a boon for us.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, sir. And we are looking forward.
Thank you, sir.
Continue the sessions always with you. You always find a little bit time for us whenever you have, so that we should not always be, also be a burden for you. But maybe whenever we feel we have time, please be connected.
Sure. Definitely. You are doing a great job here. That's a really great service. Because Rasa Shastra is not only to enrich your knowledge, Rasa Shastra is also a Shashvatam Punyam. So it is going to be a boon to everyone. So nice to be here on this platform. And thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to share my ideas with all you people who are the real lovers of Rasa Shastra. Okay. Thank you so much.
And I thank you all the participants for joining and making this a successful event. Thank you so much. See you, sir, again very soon.
Yeah.
We'll take time. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Namaste. Good night. Shubh Ratri, all of you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.